For Kristen, Lisa, and Viki. All of the great pictures you are about to see in this video, Kristen took with her digital or phone camera. The castle images I found in her collection of favorite pictures. I put a few things on CD for Kristen's memorial. I wasn't able to play it that day, but I'd like to share it with you now. This slideshow is my way of saying, not goodbye, but I'll see you again, Kristen, before too long. In the normal or average course of events, things like this are not supposed to happen. Parents are not supposed to memorialize their children. Children are supposed to memorialize their parents. One of the first things Kristen said to me when I told her I was flying to Ohio to be with her and her mom at the hospital was, "No crying allowed." She was strong, and she wanted others to be strong as well. So today, as then, she would want all of us to be strong. With a pretty clear understanding of what was happening to her, she still looked only towards recovery and life. When the doctors told Kristen the cancer had spread to her ovaries, she said, rather pragmatically, "Well, take them out then. I'm not opposed to adoption." With that said, however, she did take care to see that all of her debts were paid off. As she looked towards the future, I think she also realized that she may not have one here. She wanted so much to have children. She loved kids, and they all truly loved her, especially her cousins Aubrey, Kevin, Brandon, and Amber. Every year, Kristen would fly to North Carolina and use her vacation time exploring North Carolina with them and Kelly. I began to notice in the last 4 years of having Kristen with us that if you wanted to build or nurture a relationship with her, she would give it everything she could. She never forgot birthdays, holidays, or special occasions of any kind. She was always on top of it, remembered everybody's birthday. She was always picking up gifts of some kind, balloons, flowers, cards, for people she loved and felt connected to. It seems like it would be impossible to go on without her, but I know she would want everybody to continue with their own journeys and try to do the things you want to do and be happy. If you have a desire to feel connected to Kristen, you could give to a charity that she was fond of. It's called the St. Joseph Indian School. It benefits the children of the Sioux Nation so that they have a better chance to succeed. Another way to connect with Kristen is to watch any of the Ginger Rogers, Fred Astaire movies, or Rogers and Hammerstein, or any Disney movie. She loved all those things. Now, if you don't mind, I wrote a few things for Kristen that I wanted to share. I'm not sure they qualify as poems, but here goes. It wasn't so apparent when she was still in our sight that she spent her short time here in fair nature's light, where her abidance to honesty would in the end mean that she always stayed loyal to truth and to right. As a proud father, I admired her virtuous life. I like to kid myself and say it was because I did something right, but it was her who did the teaching so that her father might get it right. Intellectually way ahead of me, she always was very bright. These memories will linger, heartbreaking yet sweet, of the last days, last hour, of the last happy years, when our baby left us with oh so many tears. She's now among those soaring on high, so if you feel a slight breeze at your temple, don't worry, it's only Kristen saying goodbye. Her cousins all adored her with a love you cannot taint. She paid them her attention with the patience of a saint. She lavished them with a loving playfulness that only she knew how to do. And I know that they all loved her and that they will miss her too. But for so long as they can hold her memory, their love will always be true. From the year 1066, the Battle of Hastings followed you here, with its vivid memories you held so dear. The thought of those talks we had only served to bring a tear. You said, "Now the castle ruins look lonely." And as you sighed, you said, "If only. The inhabitants now gone and scattered, they're left alone and tattered. With skilled masonry work giving way, they look like they never mattered." As we agreed during those talks, we've all been here before. Just the same, we know there will be more. Daddy will see you again, then. With your thoughts fixed in history, perhaps that's where you went, to breathe life back into those places you know you have been. And finally, I want to say a few words about Kristen's friend Lisa, so that you might come away with an idea of how special she was in Kristen's life. When Lisa and Mike decided to get married, Kristen wasn't losing a friend, she gained another dear friend in Mike. Soon, Lisa and Mike were expecting their first child. His name is Mikey, and Kristen affectionately called him the Beast. Again, she wasn't losing two good friends, she gained a family, a young family who loved her as much as she loved them. She was so proud and so happy for her friends. When Kristen was admitted to the hospital, right away, Lisa had her mother come to Ohio so somebody could look after the Beast while she spent almost every waking hour with Kristen. I watched and listened as the two of them talked, and in wonder, I saw that she was bound to Kristen's side by a strength of friendship and love that only omnipotence could break, a friendship that I'm sure transcends even death. She was there to see how quickly everything seemed to happen and how scary everything was. Lisa shared with us some of the last happy moments and all of the sad ones. She lost as much as anybody when Kristen left, perhaps even more. After I heard Viki speak at Kristen's memorial, I had to say a few words about her here. Viki obviously knew Kristen quite well. She perfectly described her when she talked about how thoughtful and kind Kristen was to her and her family. Kristen really was a loyal friend to those who were lucky enough to get to know her. Viki, too, lost an important part of her life when Kristen left, and she will, I'm sure, always remember her.
There's a song that's inside of my soul. It's the one that I've tried to write over and over again. I'm awake in the infinite cold, but you sing to me over and over and over again. So I lay my head back down and I lay